Well, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you. Thank you for being here. I'm Senator Pat Gallivan, Senator Dave Valesky. I was going to say Carlucci this way. Senator Kathy Marchione, Senator
Dave Carlucci.
Yeah. Representing the Senate Majority Coalition, and it's very significant that we worked on this project together, and this was done in a bipartisan manner. Last June, many of you may remember, the Senate Majority Coalition began a process to reduce the regulatory burden in New York State. In addition to comprehensive legislation that was passed last June and subsequent significant outreach throughout the state, our bipartisan commission conducted 9 industry-specific hearings across the state in an effort to hear directly from business owners, entrepreneurs, and industry experts about the regulatory environment in New York State, to learn about the specific regulations negatively impacting their businesses and potential ways to make New York more hospitable to private sector job creation. The findings report that we are releasing today represents the culmination of this process and includes testimony from over 100 individuals that participated in one of the 9 forums or took the time to submit written testimony to the commission. During the course of this bipartisan fact-finding effort, several common issues emerged as seemingly inherent problems within the state's regulatory structure and bureaucracy, big picture items, as opposed to the specific regulations. These include agencies should provide guidance in navigating complex regulations, which often can be more burdensome than complying with the regulation itself. Agencies should work cooperatively with businesses towards compliance rather than immediately penalizing them. Agencies should be held accountable to timely respond to permit, license, and grant applications, as well as inquiries from various businesses. Agencies should develop fair and predictable regulations. Commissioners should be held accountable to conduct an agency-by-agency review of all regulations as is currently required by law. Agencies should communicate to avoid conflicting regulatory interpretations, and the legislature should strengthen the State Administrative Procedure Act. While addressing these big picture ideas are important in improving New York State's regulatory environment, identifying specific regulations are just as important and will provide the logical starting point for comprehensive reform. The Senate Majority Coalition decided that the best way to identify individual regulatory burdens was to focus on specific industries vital to regional and statewide economic growth. This process helped to identify 2,219 specific rules, regulations, and practices that put New York's businesses at a competitive disadvantage. Each specific burden corresponds to a specific regulation or section of law or a practice of a state agency that has the effect of a regulation or statute in that it creates a burden on business as if it were validly enacted law or rule. Unfortunately, no one has yet been able to put a price tag on the total economic cost of New York's more than 750,000 regulations. However, a 2009 study found that regulations in California, a state with a similarly burdensome regulatory regime, cost their economy $493 billion annually, resulting in a loss of 3.8 million jobs and reducing business tax receipts by over $16 billion. This report is a continuation of efforts begun last year, and the Senate Majority Coalition hopes it'll serve as a blueprint in working with Governor Andrew Cuomo towards his stated goal, consistent with ours, of reducing the regulatory burden for job creators in New York State and achieving substantive regulatory reform this legislative session.
Thank you, Senator Gallivan. I'm pleased to have participated in this effort. And if we just go back to the end of last session, Senators Skelos and Klein, the coalition, majority coalition leaders, to their credit, made the determination, I think for the first time ever, from the perspective of this Senate. You know, we always hear in our individual districts from individual business owners and those advocacy organizations that come to Albany year after year about those twin pillars that prevent job retention and job growth: high taxes and an overburdensome regulatory structure. But again, for the first time, at least to my knowledge, a formal structure was established by the coalition leaders, creating this task force, which the four of us interpreted as a fact-finding mission to spend the off session to travel around the state, as Senator Gallivan said, 9 industry-specific hearings all across the state, additional mechanisms by which to receive input and suggestions that has led to this report. You all have a folder that includes a CD of the recommendations. We have a link to our website that I'm sure you'll all want to see exactly what we are suggesting. I am pleased at the end of this process, the end of the formal process, as far as this task force is concerned, more work will be done, but very pleased last week in the governor's state of the state to hear of his direct interest in the issue of regulatory relief for businesses. As all of you know, he has also called for a study and a commission to look at that, and it is our intent to immediately submit this report to him in advance of his commission. And we're saying to the governor, we have already done much of the legwork. We have a tremendous number of recommendations that we believe the various executive agencies should be taking an immediate and hard look at for future action, both on the administrative side and where we heard legislative issues or impediments to business growth that the legislature could deal with. It's our intent to be in direct contact, but certainly with the standing committee chairs here in the Senate for further action on many of the items that you'll see as you review the report. So it's been a great process. My colleagues and I think, learned a lot through this process, and we're very, very anxious to continue to move the process forward. Senator Marchione is the chair of the Administrative and Regulatory Review Commission, and she played a key role in this effort as well. Kathy?
Thank you. Thank you, Senator. You know, as we stood here back in June and we let some of our legislation, one being we're going to look at 1,000 rules and regulations, we got questions at that time with, you're really going to find 1,000 rules and regulations? You know, I am so proud that we kept our promise. In fact, we exceeded our promise to identify 1,000 state rules and regulations that do hamper business, that hurt taxpayers and hamstrung New York's competitiveness. We did identify 2,219 specific rules and regulations for revision or elimination. And our regulatory effort has been a bipartisan, unprecedented, team-based approach. You know, as chair of the Senate's Administrative Regulations Review Commission, I'm proud to have worked side by side with these senators. And I also want to just take a moment to thank all of our staffs because they worked diligently in making this happen as well. So I do just want to thank them and know that our report has been a labor of love and certainly many, many miles on our vehicles and on ourselves. It is the product of surveys, meetings, community outreach, and input by more than 100 business owners, organizations, and individuals who took part in one of the 9 industry-specific public forums conducted throughout the state. You know, I chaired a forum in my district at Quad Graphics, and it was incredibly helpful to hear from respected business owners and leaders like the Turf Hotels' Michael Hoffman, the owner of the Turf Hotels, and the Willard Mountain, Chick Wilson, about what Albany could do to stop hurting and start helping them. And one of the examples that Mr. Wilson gave was, you know, we're experts in our business, but not all of us are expert in regulations. And it cost us money to have to hire people who can handle the regulations in the state, and we need help. You know, taken to its conclusion, our report will make a real difference for a more affordable Empire State. And while I was pleased that the governor cited the regulatory reform as a priority, I'm thrilled to be able to pass this report on to him as a starting basis for to even go further and than what we've done. You know, my colleagues and I have a list of regulations already identified. We feel it's time to stop talking and start cutting Albany's 22 miles of job-killing red tape. Today's release of our bipartisan report puts our goal of less Albany red tape, rules, and regulations, and more jobs, opportunity and prosperity for all New Yorkers in sight and within grasp. Now let's make it happen this session, this year. Thank you.
Senator Carlucci. Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm Senator David Carlucci, representing Rockland and Westchester counties. And I just want to say it's been an honor and a privilege to work with my colleagues standing here on this very important commission. What we talk about in moving New York forward is really the heart of this report. If we can reform the regulations, if we can really look at the structure in how we operate government, in making sure that we're working with small businesses, with organizations hand in hand, that when they develop best practices, we can implement them quickly. So in this report, there's 2,219 specific regulations that we were able to find in just these 9 hearings around the state. As was mentioned before, there's over 750,000 regulations on the books. So we're not going to be able to go through and identify each one. But what we can do are highlight some of the outliers. And in addition to that, make some structural changes going forward. In the press release that you received, we recommend 4 pieces of legislation that we're all sponsoring. The bill that I'm sponsoring, we've passed in the Senate before, and we're hopeful we'll get it on the governor's desk this year. And what that is to allow for organizations around the state, whether it's a trade group, to be able to petition state agencies that if they find a best practice, a new technology, a new way of doing business, that there's a process, there's a way to be able to reform the system so that we don't need the system of the past, but we have a new advanced system in place. I know from personal experience as a former town clerk, you know, dealing with the regulations that we have. And something as simple as how we keep records and our records retention system is something that costs taxpayer dollars. And I found some records that we were keeping that I said, why are we keeping these? Would ask questions to state agencies and just get the answer, well, it's in the records retention schedule, so you have to keep it. Well, that's not good enough. When you have to pay thousands of dollars to keep thousands of records every year, we need reform. We need a way to clarify the system, get answers, and make sure we're using an up-to-date system. So with that, I look forward to continuing to work with my colleagues, with the governor, with the assembly, to have regulatory reform in the state of New York, to make sure that we're helping small businesses and families around this great state. So with that, I think we're going to open up to questions.
This is the report. You have that on your disk, and in the release, there's also a link that you can go to the Senate website and access it right online. We obviously did not print a whole bunch of this because I don't know if you'd read all of it. It includes the transcripts of all of the testimony. You also have in your packet the executive summary of the report and the conclusion. Each of those 2,219 regulations cited are contained in here. They're listed out, and there's a footnote with a citation where each is located. So that's what this is. It's a packet that you have. We're thrilled to produce this report. Now we're very excited that the governor has called for regulatory reform, and the work starts today. And hopefully we can get together with the governor, work with him, and say there's no reason to go have 100 people testify again. There is no reason to have additional hearings across the state where the same people say the same exact thing. As Senator Valesky mentioned, we think the bulk of the work is done, and it's time to move on some of this stuff. So we will take questions and try to answer them as best as we can, if you have any.
Could you say, just, was there any theme to some of the most problematic regulations, or were there any agencies in which most of these problems or regulations were based?
There were general themes, general themes being that pile of regulations, those books with all the regulations contained in there, is an incredible maze to try to navigate, and they can't do it. It's more burdensome. Very often, they can't find state agencies or individuals in state government that can help them get through the process, and there are those where state agencies are in conflict with each other. State agencies are not accountable as far as time deadlines and getting back to them and working with them. So those were the general themes, that the culture of state government was problematic as well as those maze of regulations. There was some that were testified at just about every hearing. They're cited in there. The notification provision of the Wage Theft Prevention Act was one of them. And we have an estimate of their, in that we believe that it costs employers upwards of $180 million across the state. Now, that $180 million that costs employers is passed on to consumers, so it costs everybody. The scaffold law, which I know that there are people that fall on both sides of it, was talked about at almost every hearing. Unfunded mandates, it crossed into government. Just the term was talked about all the time. But we got into some things when we talked with certain groups. They got very specific, like Senator Marchione mentioned when people were talking about the hospitality industry, they talked about things specific to them. One that came up with car dealers, and it only affects them, is a requirement that they keep a written record of their inventory subject to inspection by a motor vehicle inspector upon demand. Well, that takes them 15 minutes per car. We've estimated that costs several million dollars for new cars alone, and we would argue that, just like the report that we gave you on a disc, those records, the dealers have, they all have computers, and they fill out the paperwork, they go to their computer, pull it up, and write it out. So we had similar things like that, Tom, that that the regulations have not kept up with technology. There are a number of those in there. But outside of that, it was really the bigger picture, the culture of state agencies, the lack of responsiveness, the timeliness, and that incredible maze in how hard it is to navigate without help from state agencies.
Senator, Governor was talking about New York open for business. He had the regional councils, which were aimed at trying to limit the red tape, one-stop shopping. Do you feel like those have been effective in limiting, you know, having different agencies that business has to go to deal with whatever issue it has?
There was some discussion about that process in the consolidated funding application, and the general acknowledgement was that it was still a hard process, but they recognized that the state was trying to do it a better way. People aren't used to that yet, but it's still problematic to find somebody that can assist them through the process. So a number of people, a number of businesses testified about that process, thought in general terms it was a good idea, but it's still unwieldy. The seeker process was another one that came up all the time, even though there's been some attempts to streamline that. That's very unwieldy and very expensive and very costly.
The governor's talked about that the legislature doesn't have the appetite to deal with the scaffolding law, the WICS law, some of these big pieces that have been out there for decades. Do you think that the legislature would be poised to pass something?
I will speak by myself. I have that appetite. Senate Bill 111 modifies the scaffold law to allow for comparative negligence. We have spoken with the governor's office about it. We had numerous people testify. There's a group representing over 50 different organizations that is advocating for modification. Now, obviously, not everybody in the coalition, I don't mean necessarily the four of us, but the, what's our number, 34? 35, 36? The 35, 36 senators might not be in complete agreement, but I, for one, think it should be on the floor, it should be debated, and make a decision on it. But I think that there is an appetite for us to make changes. It's a matter of getting enough people together to support any specific piece of legislation, any specific change. And don't forget, we still have to deal with the assembly and then the concurrence of the governor's office.
Let me just add to that point. The issues to which action by the legislature would be required to address, we all, the four of us, as we move through this process, believed it very important that as we reflected on the purpose of this task force, which was to be a fact-finding mission, that we in no way, shape, or form short-circuit the Senate Standing Committee process. So where there are legislative issues that met some or many, in fact, may have testified, whether it be Senator Gallivan's bill, it's important for the chairman, I believe that bill is referred to the Judiciary Committee, that the chairman of the committee, the members of the committee, have an opportunity to address that bill through the normal legislative process. The one other thing, Tom, to your question, general themes you had asked about what we were hearing across the state and across all agencies. One of the things we heard about time and time again had to do with time. So many business owners would tell us that if they were applying for a permit or a license or some other document that was important from the state, that if they were not timely with providing that information to the agency, that there could be significant penalties for financial penalties for actions that they may be intending to take. The reverse was not the case. That delay, and while there have been improvements, I think, through the consolidated funding application process, there still is a relatively long period of time that agencies often work with businesses who are seeking assistance through the state. So that seemed to be one of the common themes throughout all our findings.
Did you address in the report any solution, a global solution, I guess, maybe, to regulations in New York? Or are you going to have to just hack away at every single rule and regulation?
Well, a little of both. I mean, right now our goal was to address, as senators have indicated, over 2,000 individual items that we've acknowledged. But one of the global solutions that we've discussed and are anxious to move forward on, you know, there really is no structure in place to do a regular review of the regulatory burden that is imposed on businesses. Many regulations have been around not only for years, but decades. Some of them may have become obsolete because of technology, because of other laws that have been passed that may supersede. So there ought to be a regular review process in place going forward on a regular basis to streamline the process going forward.
Would that be something like providing the Talking Head Board, you know, they looked at every single regulation, that's all they did was to try to overturn some of these things. Do you think that's an idea that you should have?
Very well, maybe.
So, and let me just add to that. There's current legislation that requires an agency-by-agency review every 5 years. That's not being done by all the agencies. So the combination of what's existing and then some of our specific pieces of legislation, the four that Senator Carlucci mentioned, is intended to strengthen that process and address the big picture in a much more timely way than it's being done now.
And just to add to that five-year review, that a lot of that does go through the ARC Commission, and we really had discovered that there were some agencies this year that had not done their five-year review, and we certainly got to them and requested and required them to submit their five-year review, and they did. So we are trying to make sure we stay on top of it as well and do what we can with the current rules and regulations.
Do you get a sense that of these more than 2,000 problematic regulations, were most of them a result of legislation, or were they direct action by the state agencies on their own?
We didn't quantify it that way, but clearly there is some of both. Some, you know, legislation often directs the various agency to promulgate the rules and regulations, and then they do. So sometimes the legislation's problematic, and we could probably do a better job of looking at that when we're directing additional regulations. Some of it is agencies as well.
What were the silliest regulations you came across in this process, in your opinion?
Well, I don't know the silliest. One that sticks in my mind is a requirement that those in the insurance industry have to use buff colored paper for some specific thing.
Buff colored?
Yeah. It's a little off-white. Instead of regular white bond paper, they have to use a certain color paper when they're making some notification. Or the requirement that insurance companies have to send two copies of, I think, I don't know if it was the claim or two copies of what they adjusted to the individual's attorney instead of just one copy. There's many like those. Many of them are escaping me right now.
You know, who determines whether something's buff or white?
That's the ridiculousness of it. No idea. And also, I don't even know if anybody is complying with it, but it's in place.
Right.
And somebody could be held accountable if they're not complying.
Did anybody ask why? Buff colored, not white?
We did. But nobody knew why.
Did they know why?
We did not ask. But no, I don't know why. That's in there, and there's a specific citation if you wanted to look further. The other thought that I had was that the testimony of everybody is included on your desk. We essentially didn't filter anything. It was a fact-finding mission, so if somebody testified that a regulation, rule, law was burdensome to them, It's listed in the report.
What changes, if any, do you recommend to see, President?
We didn't look into it and dissect it, but one of the things that was identified as problematic was the timeliness, where the developer has time deadlines when they submit things. But when they submit things, they describe this great big black hole that it goes into. And as they're carrying the property, they're investing money in it, they're paying taxes on it, it costs them more and more as time goes on. So the biggest thing that people testified about that we are in agreement is the timeliness, on the lack of timeliness on the part of state agencies, that they should be required to respond within certain guidelines. What they are, though, we didn't get that nitty-gritty about things.
I know that there are some bills out there that are going to be aligned to come up with a lesser amount of those proposals.
No, we haven't done that, but the issue of seeker is a perfect example. We are all in agreement that should we make a specific recommendation about seeker, it should include the consult of Senator Grisanti as the chair of the Environmental Conservation Committee.
On that topic of state delay,
this is sort of a hot button issue, but did anybody bring up, and would any of the four of you have any thoughts on, the state has been studying fracking regulations for well over a year now, and there appears to be no timetable set on that. Comments?
Point well taken.
Further comments?
We actually, because of the various hearings that have taken place regarding hydrofracking, environmental conservation was not one of the industry-specific hearings that we held, although there was conservation issues that people did bring up. A few people, when we were down in Corning, testified about the lack of decision on that, but ultimately they didn't point to any specific regulation, so we don't have any recommendations one way or the other regarding that particular issue listed in the report.
Senator, how about the governor's $2 billion tax plan that he unveiled last week? Does that fit into what you're talking about here, or do you have some concerns about that tax issue?
Well, I think the taxes and the regulations go hand in hand, and those are the two things that keep New York on the list of the 47th, 48th, 49th, 50th place in the country, least business-friendly in the country, highest taxed, most regulated. They go hand in hand, and I think I think I could safely say that we all support reforms in both areas. How exactly we would do it, there might be a little bit of a disagreement, but our focus in this in these hearings and in this effort was the regulations. If a tax issue was brought up, we referred it over to Senator DeFrancisco, Senator Marcelino, who are going through a similar process, and it may or may not have been included in their report and recommendations.
Okay. All right. Thank you all very
Thanks,
much.
Everybody. Any questions? Follow up Contact later on. Us. Thank you.